There's a place called a gin mill way down in the slums. There's a place called a gin mill way down in the slums. My baby goes that night and stays till the morning comes. Oh, she drinks gin.
Hey, what's going on?
Welcome to Blind Hit Confessions.
We are in Warsaw. We haven't been on the road in a little while. At least this far.
Not for a show, no.
No?
It's nice.
You guys usually stay in the Fishers area?
We've been doing a lot of home.
We're based out of like Fishers over at Ali's Ale House. So, you know, as he's getting used back into his new job, and some of the other pigs are a little have family, and it's summer and vacations are going, so it's a little harder to always pick up lately for a little while and go out and about. So
we'll try and do Tuesdays at Ali's with us, but other than that, weekend stuff, him and I can travel, so yeah. We go around and hit the breweries.
But it's been a couple months, I think, since we went somewhere for a little bit. So, but it's good to be out and about. Yeah. It was a nice scenic drive up through Silver Lake and
you came up 15?
Elmwood and something or another.
Yeah.
Stuck behind a smart car doing 50 miles an hour the whole way, of course.
Yep.
I kept passing him. Hey, you need to pedal faster.
Every time you want to pass, it's a double line.
Yeah. You need to pedal much faster,
you're on
please.
A hill.
You pass them, the next car is doing 40.
Either that or they need to pick the car up and scoot it back a couple times to get a charge and let it go again. You know, those.
You could have got stuck behind an Amish buggy. So
that's true, I guess.
Great. That'll be the way back.
That will be. Yeah.
Before we keep going, the voices you hear, Abby and Craig from Ledgeview Brewing, this is what brought us to Warsaw. So we are love having you guys let us come out here and have some beer and barbecue.
True.
That's what we do.
Yes, that's what I'm excited for. I am excited for the barbecue.
Hobbies put together?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Eating
and
drinking.
They're awful happy.
It's a
horrible combination of hobbies. I mean, geez, come on. I mean, be original. Gee, come on.
I was just hoping I wouldn't suck at both of them.
Well, you weren't going to suck at one of them. Craig's actually, his background is, he's a chef.
Right.
And that's how it started.
Are you too as well or no?
I did go to culinary school.
Okay.
And I graduated.
With pastry or what was your,
culinary. We call it culinary, but the savory, not pastry. Yeah.
Ah, okay, gotcha.
That's actually how we met, because I did my internship at what was then the West in Providence, and that's where he was working.
Oh, yes, Rhode Island native and a Goshen native.
Goshen, Indiana,
correct. So Rhode Island, I'm going to go with New England fan, and we won't try not to hold that against you, but it's okay.
It's all right.
It's true, though.
Yeah, pretty much have to be New England everything, or you get disowned by the
family. Well, you can't go home. You can't go home again. Yeah, you're like, if they ever see you in a Colts jersey, you're kind of in trouble.
That was this one.
How did that go with the family?
Someone had to represent.
We watched one of the
playoff game.
The playoff game, and she was the only one in the room with the. With the Colts, and it was about 50 other people in Patriots game.
And the Colts were getting creamed, and
of course.
I think we made one good play, and I stood up and went, yeah! And the whole room just went silent.
Of course. Like, shut up, Abby.
Yeah. Sit down!
It's a clear delineation in the room. Abby's over here.
Get back in a car.
It was very
get back in your car. Come on.
Hey, he married me anyway.
He likes controversy.
We're bread on it.
Yeah, exactly.
Gotta have some drama.
You guys are out in Rhode Island. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You both were cooking there. Were you guys both working as chefs there in Rhode Island, or?
I wasn't a chef. I was just a peon line cook.
Okay.
Like not even a line cook. I was a prep cook.
Oh.
If anything.
Okay.
Yeah, and I took on events and catering there, and eventually got promoted to exec sous, and that's when Abby and I decided to take off.
Yeah.
And we went up to Chicago.
Ooh.
Yeah, she worked over on the Magnificent Mile.
Well, technically, I was at the Fairmont.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think, not technically, but it was a nice place.
Mm-hmm. What took you to Chicago?
Just wanted to get out of Rhode Island. You know, we were married in 07. He's like, I've lived here my whole life. Get me out of here. I was like, yeah, sure, not a problem.
Well, let's go.
And we figured if we were in Chicago, we'd be 3 hours away from my family.
Sure.
So if the fit hit the Shan,
we'd
still be okay. And so we were there. Well, it was 2008, and we all started losing our jobs left and right. So I lost my job first in November, and then Craig lost his job 3 days before Christmas.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
It was so dumb.
Yep. And then I was offered a lovely position in St. Louis.
Yep. So we've been down there for a little bit.
Yeah, like we have to lose you from this property, but we don't want to lose you from the company.
What?
You know, I was under one of the giant umbrella corporations there.
And, gotcha.
And so they sent me down there and, helped take over the property. And we decided, all right, either back to Chicago or back to Boston.
St. Louis wasn't doing it for you.
We were there for about a year?
We were there for a year.
And we knew we wanted a family.
Yeah.
And I said, this is no place.
Not it.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, there are some good
areas. Having a little trouble with the St. Louis Mafia?
No. People talk about how Chicago's dangerous. St. Louis can be
really
rough. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Really?
I worked at the Union Station Hotel. And there's a big boulevard right in front of the hotel that goes all the way down to the arch. And people would say, oh, I want to go for a walk. Where should I go? Well, you want to stay on this side of the road. You want to go down to the arch. You want to come back. If it gets dark, take a cab. Really? Yes. It is. It used to be. And I'm assuming. I haven't heard that it's gotten any better.
Yeah, I don't know. St. Louis always seemed to me is kind of.
No.
It's just St. Louis. No. You know? I had a friend. I mean, back when I lived in Arizona, I worked with a kid at one of the clubs, nightclubs I DJ'd at, and he swore to God he was part of the St. Louis, his family was part of the St. Louis Mafia, and I'm like, St. Louis Mafia? What?
It's
St. Louis.
You know, there are
St. Louis got a mafia?
There are some great areas down there. There's a great brewery down there called Schlafly that we really enjoy.
Oh, yeah.
But there's also a really great barbecue place
down there.
There's
another brewery we're not too fond of there, you know?
Yeah.
It shall remain nameless.
We had toyed.
Big brother.
Because we tend to go through a yearly pig trip. And we've been down to Tennessee and Kentucky. And Wisconsin's always a big, easy one to go to because.
Oh, yeah.
Michigan.
Beer, you know?
You just throw a stone.
The home of beer. And even now, it's even more throw a stone and you will hit 10 breweries now and distilleries. Yeah. But St. Louis was going to be one of our trips because there's some decent ones. We just haven't gotten that way. And now I'm kind of scared to go.
I don't want to be too scared. I mean, that's the thing. It's like any city. You just got to know where to go and where not to go.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, of course.
The best thing about it, though, is that's where we got the bug for the barbecue.
Yeah.
You know, we actually got to live and enjoy real barbecue.
You have some amazing barbecue in St. Louis.
Oh, they had some great barbecue. Yep. There was, we can say the name, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably one of our favorite restaurants there. It's Pappy's.
Pappy's?
I haven't been there.
Pappy's Barbecue.
Yeah?
Amazing. And it's about the same size as this, about the same amount of seating. You walk in, and you're not allowed to save seats. And if you save a seat, some guy comes over and he's like, nope. Well, what if I can't get a seat? And he said to me, I can't explain it, but it always works. You will find a seat, I promise. And we were there probably twice a month.
Yep.
Never had a problem. Always got a seat. You know Craig and I like a restaurant if, one, we go back, and two, if we start trying every single thing on the menu time we go back. And that was one of those restaurants.
Awesome.
It's amazing.
I think you use that here at Ledgeview about the seating thing. Did you bring that with you?
The open seating, yes, but not. We don't. Right now, saving seats isn't an. I mean, sometimes it's an issue, but the nice thing is when we get slammed like that, it's usually on a really nice day, so we can throw a lot of people
outside,
out on the patio.
Yeah.
By the way, that's a new voice. I told you I'd get her on the microphone. I told you to get headphones on her.
Hey, Tosh.
That's our head bartender, Tasha.
So, question though, having culinary background, do you have to, because I've done this before, like being a DJ, I'd go to other bars and I'd be like, God, this DJ sucks. Do you find yourself having to turn off any of your culinary criticisms to try to enjoy, to not go in preconceived, you know what I mean? That's the hardest part for me was trying to go into a place and be like, all right, I'm going to give this guy a chance. Granted, this kid's like 20 years old, and I know all he can do is go, wiki, 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 boom. Is it better to have the culinary background, you think, or worse?
To a degree.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, I wouldn't say, it's like when you're on the swim team and all of a sudden you get into a pool, you're like, I can't have fun in a pool anymore.
Right.
It's that same kind of idea.
Yeah.
For him, for both of us, it's the food, but for me, it's the service. I think I always, I'm always like, oh, they should have done this.
You have to bite your tongue, too,
yes.
And not be too critical of them going,
exactly.
Everybody's having a bad day. Somebody might be having a bad day. They may just be,
I think maybe sometimes a little too forgiving. There was one place in St. Louis, though. Remember that place? Oh, my God, it was horrible. It actually wasn't in St. Louis. It was in one of the towns outside of St. Louis. Mm. And we walk in, and it had been recommended to me by one of my managers. Like, you got to go to this place. It was an Italian restaurant. And we pop in. First red flag. was right when you entered in the foyer, was a cardboard cutout of their lounge singer pointing at you with, like, gun fingers,
wow.
Like he's going, hey.
Nice.
Kind of made me think of, like, the buddy Jesus in,
yeah, well,
in
I'm
Dogma.
Going with that.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so we walk
buddy Christ.
Yes, exactly. So yes. We walk in, we sit down. Our waiter comes up. He's absolutely miserable, like in this most miserable mood. And he's wearing one of those half aprons, and he had probably 15 pens just lined up. And the place is dead. All we could think of was, what, you think you're going to be busy?
14 of them are dry.
Right. No.
So we're sitting there. The bar is, like, off to our right, kind of behind me. And I said, oh, what beers do you have on tap? And he gets this really smart, alecky, looks over his shoulder.
Like,
well,
yeah,
we've got Bud, we got Blue Moon, we got Red, we got Killian's, we got... Like, okay, I'll have whatever. The food came.
He threw the plates at us.
He threw the plates at us, like, bang, right on the table. And the food was not enjoyable. And Craig at the end was like, don't you tip him. Don't you tip him. You tip everybody. Don't you tip him.
Yeah, the best part was when the crooner finally came out. And he,
was
yeah.
it just you guys, though, in the bar? Was
there were, there were,
other
I think there
people?
Were two other tables, and maybe
tables
a couple
like
people at the bar.
At
and
the
a
bar.
Crooner.
And
why?
This guy,
yeah.
He walked around, and he's like...
thought he was Dean Martin or something.
Oh, no, no. Hey.
Hey.
Check.
Gave, yep, yeah, I'm out.
Gave me the double yeah. bangers, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going that way.
Yeah, we already saw you when we walked in the door.
Yeah. couldn't miss him.
Literally, they could have just sat the cutout next to your table with an iPod. There you go.
Oh,
wow, yeah,
God.
That's pretty good.
Still one of the robots from the supermarket that they have go around now.
Oh, gosh, those things are so scary. Those things are so scary. They scare the kids, by the way. So that's probably the worst experience. So that's probably the most critical, and even that was just laughable. Otherwise, you know, we walk into places, and you know, you have an open mind. It's like every like fancy, like the shishi stuff has its time and its place.
Sure.
You know, I'm not going to walk into a place like this and expect tablecloth service and crummers you know, the works.
Well, good. Well, and that's it's always just a question I like to ask, because when you get people who are in an industry and then they go visit other places in that industry, I'm always curious, is their mind open? Because I know a lot of people who they go in super critical, and I used to do that and had to catch myself to, hey, man, let this guy do what he's doing and blah, blah, blah. His situation's different than mine. So I just always like to ask that question, how that affects some of your viewpoints on it.
Well,
but either way, you can say anything else this whole show. The fact that she gave me a Kevin Smith that she pulled a Kevin Smith reference. We're right here now.
We're good.
We're good.
I see you.
Yeah. Clerks 3 is filming right now.
I did hear,
God,
yeah.
No.
We do offer salt and pepper grinders here.
Ooh.
No shaker. It's
you
all
have
grinders.
It's the fancy kind, yeah.
What about Parmesan cheese? Do I get some?
We have a four cheese
barbecue.
I think Craig has some hidden in the back.
Thank you. I need
pasta. So where did the brewing start? Because you said St. Louis was where the barbecue started.
That was my fault.
Oh.
Well, the chef career really will it'll take you over. And, you know, we had, you know, family and kids by this point. You know, he'd worked his way up to executive sous chef, executive chef level. And Craig, it was working home. And I was like, you need a hobby. So I was out in New England, they have a wholesale club called BJ's. It's like Sam's Club or Costco.
Yep.
And they had those homebrew kits, you know, with the glass jug.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
They
stovetop.
Yep.
Someone to go do
stovetop. I think
do
I bought
do
you
do
one
do
for Christmas.
Stovetop one or garage site? Or Mr. Beer, the Mr. Beer one?
Yeah.
Tasha got me Mr.
I think
Beer for Christmas.
I don't remember the name.
Oh, no,
it was glass.
Oh, okay. Yours was fancier. His was the plastic.
Yeah.
Yours was the plastic barrel, basically, right?
Oh, yep. I've seen those.
Yeah, that's the Mr. Beer.
Okay.
You should have seen his face when he opened it. It was like a child on Christmas morn.
It was amazing.
The Brooklyn Brewing Company.
Brooklyn Brewing Company.
Yeah, the little 1 gallon kit.
Yeah.
So I said, here. He's like, oh, okay. And he did it. And he's like, actually, I kind of like this.
Interesting.
And you meet a few more. And then he said, you know what? I want some criticism. Because everyone's going to tell me I'm making good beer.
Right.
And honestly, I don't remember if the first one was.
I think it's the whole chef part of it. You're so used to getting feedback and you're criticizing everything that you do.
Yeah.
That, I just had, I don't know, I just felt like I was missing it.
So you did a lemonade stand outside, eh?
I did. Yeah. All the neighbors were like our number one, were everything, you know.
But, so he's like, I just want some criticism when I know if I'm doing a good job because, you know, you're all my friends and family. You're telling me I'm doing, you know, this is good. So he entered, what was it, Best of Boston Homebrew Competition.
Mm-hmm.
And he won in a category, awesome. Like right off the bat. I think he'd nice. Been doing it for, what, 3-4 months?
Mm-hmm.
Like, kid?
Now, what did you win with?
That was a bourbon barrel stout.
Really?
Yeah.
Jeez. Good grief.
Good Lord, really?
That's good.
It was pretty good.
Yeah.
How did you get a bourbon barrel stout at, and it was your first? Where were you getting the barrels at? You were already barreling?
No, well, I got the oak cubes.
Oh, okay.
Soaked it in my...
It's still homebrew. Yeah. It's still homebrew.
Yeah, you homebrew pro.
Yeah. Yeah. Soaked them in my favorite bourbon, which is the Buffalo Trace.
Okay, and, there you go. All right.
You know, threw that back in there.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, I was going to say, man, it goes over the top quick. Although, I feel like maybe she was just telling you needed to drink more when she gave you the kit and said, you need to calm down a little bit, but, but you're... Maybe it fits with are you meticulous, like in your you know, and all that? Are you really big on the? There are artistic brewers and there are engineering brewers almost.
Yeah.
The way we kind of see a lot of them.
You use the word meticulous.
Yes.
There we go. Ready?
but no, I mean it's so. Are you big on like you know the numbers and that you really the science and the research? Or are you kind of a I'm gonna throw some shit together and see what happens?
Nah, I geek out.
You geek out on it? Okay.
Yeah. I walk around with these Hubble telescopes for a reason. And
but there's nothing wrong with that. There's two sides of those brewers. There are.
This is
like
true.
If you take Manahan over at Copacetic, art straight up artistic. I mean, and if in the terminology we use, it's. I mean, he will just, I'm going to grab this, I'm going to grab the pantry beers are really good, you know.
Sure.
What do I got in the pantry?
Mm-hmm.
But
it's
then
like
there's
a
engineers
big black
like
cauldron and just throwing shit into
yeah,
it.
Yeah, which he basically does have a big black cauldron
and
in. And over at Monticello, yeah. It's just a big thing with gas underneath it, and it
yeah.
throws some stuff in.
And
he
well,
I think his,
and he has the big gas
yep.
Yep.
Oh,
yeah.
Bubble.
He's still and he manually still stirs that stuff.
Yeah, he's got good laboratory glassware. I think he's got a private... a credit card that Abby don't know about.
Oh.
Too late. Way to go. All right, you're
damn
off
it.
The podcast now.
Who brought the cool
kind
girl?
Of like
just got totally marked out, honey.
Do you have a particular style that you like before you started brewing that you went after one of your staples? Or?
Believe it or not, just probably just being the East Coaster, I was all about Sam Adams.
Okay.
You know,
yeah.
And the
yeah.
fact that that Sam Cook, like, he was one of the originators for, like, you know, going out actually making craft beers.
Sure.
Yeah.
You
oh,
know,
yeah.
He wanted to separate everything from, you know, the InBev and
right.
from Budweiser and all that stuff and give somebody a second
right.
choice.
Thankfully,
sure.
yeah.
And just like all of us other homebrewers, you know, we started in the garage.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, he made his beer in the garage and sold it out of the back of his pickup truck.
Yep.
And,
say,
you know.
Say what you will about the guy now, but.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, it's kind of a big thing.
It's yeah. I mean, there's still some fathers. Yes, there's the grandfathers
yeah.
of the movements, you know,
mm-hmm.
around. I mean, even if you take things like Lion and Kugels and such, they were all still kind of breaking from the standard. They were rolling the Shandies and
yep.
in the Reds and things like that. And so, you know, I think one of my first beers was like a Liney Red, you know.
Actually, I think that was one of my first.
Right,
beers.
Yeah. I
absolutely.
Mean, it's just, it was something different from
PBR.
Budweiser. And well, yeah.
Yep.
But then, yeah.
Yeah. I think for me, it was like, before Coors took them over, Blue Moon and
sure.
Killian's. And,
yeah.
You know, you just didn't want to drink but. I say that.
Yes.
Yeah. We don't care. They're not coming after us.
Didn't want to drink Bud Miller.
Ribbit.
Yeah.
I just wanted something that had flavor.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's
yep.
This is true.
That's like
sugar
a,
water.
You know, one of the first times I met Abby's family, we I picked up a bunch of Sam Adams, and they came over, and he's
like,
well, I don't drink that heavy beer. Well, I'll try it.
Yeah.
He's like, that's not bad. What is that? That's called flavor.
Airports are always good for some of that good beer.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Go to a new place.
There's
yeah.
a lot of Sam
tab.
Adams that Mom yeah. and I drank in the airport about 9:15 in the a.m.
So it costs like $12 a frickin' glass though.
Yeah.
But you know,
I get a lot of flack from him, but I actually enjoy their cherry wheat. Like I like that. And every time we would go, so if you go to Boston and do the Sam Adams tour, it's free. Number one.
Sure.
At the end, you get to taste 3 beers.
Yep.
And you always get the Boston Lager. You always get what they're working on. You always get the current seasonal.
Right.
And then they tell you about this place around the corner, of the first place where Cook sold his beers
sure.
to. And so, what's the name of it? It's
Doyle's.
Doyle's Pub. So they have a little party bus that'll take you there from the brewery because parking's an absolute nightmare.
That's all I have.
Because it's Boston.
Yeah.
And
well, yes.
Or you drive over there and you're lucky if you find a spot. And you go in and they have almost every Sam Adams beer on tap. And every time I go there, I get a cherry wheat.
Nice. That's all right.
Every time.
When you know, you know.
When you know, you know.
If it's, but still, it's, if it's got flavor, I mean, that's great. I mean, they're I saw lately, I haven't tried them yet, but I think they're trying to make Bud Light and something even lighter. I mean, I swear, it's like double Bud Light or Bud Double Light or whatever. And I'm like, Jesus Christ. At this point, just call it
just
seltzer.
Don't drink
at this
anymore,
point, just
yeah.
make, I mean, you can't, you're,
they
it's
do.
Like you're taking a seltzer and a beer and just mixing yeah, them together. Just they're quit, just trying to stop. Make it even lighter and lighter, less carbs.
What's the ABV on that?
Beer flavored seltzer.
Yeah, exactly.
0.000.
It'd probably have more flavor if I took a seltzer water and just crushed up a hop in it and just kind of dropped it down. But yeah, they're going like even lighter on the calories and the carbs. Yeah.
So
you
is
know?
That the thing they're trying to get to the health conscious?
I think so. It's like, you know, yeah,
but
trying
at that
to
point, it's like, just don't think, drink beer. Just yeah, drink something
like,
else.
You're
then
really
because,
that
I mean,
health conscious? Yeah. Drink a White Claw or something for God's sakes. Or a seltzer water. I mean, if you're done, you're done.
Have some self-respect.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's not the movement we're looking for.
No, no, no.
No, they come in here. How many calories does your beer have? Freaking no. It tastes good.
Yeah.
Drink it.
How many calories does it have? All of them.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Do you want something with no calories? Here's a water.
Yeah.
That's all I got for you.
I left the ice out, so.
Yeah. If you're coming to a barbecue and beer restaurant
say,
and you're asking
about the
calories.
Place, ask about calories. There's something wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you already broke 6 of your rules before you even ordered beer.
We don't like to judge, but seriously, get out. Yeah, no, well, but.
Unreal.
All right, so what was the, did we get to what the first beer? I mean, I know
no,
you
I just
went
tell you,
to the
but
style,
staples,
yeah.
Yeah, just staple the style he liked, but
yeah. So I mean, like, I'm a traditionalist. Like, this one here, the we call it the squirrel stew, because you know you can't come to Indiana and not have squirrel stew.
Well, I literally, when someone walked in, we walked in and someone said that, and because it's a barbecue restaurant, I'm like, no shit, do you have a squirrel stew?
He's smoking squirrel.
Holy shit! Really?
I got a little excited too.
Yeah, I did. I think he did.
I was like, squirrel.
Tasha said we got squirrel stew on, and like.
Sweet.
See the soup of the day.
Sorry, but yeah, you keep going, but yeah.
No, it's all good. Like,
that's a brown, right?
This is a brown ale. It's like it's pretty much the second beer I brewed. And, you know. So
at home, not here.
At home.
At home.
And so I redid this one and made it more local. It's got maple syrup from, what is that?
Claypool.
And I don't know, this is hella
talking.
Good.
Just keep talking.
And that's what I'm trying to keep with all that stuff. Like a triple T, I mean, it's a Irish red, which is, you know, it's another brown ale.
Yeah.
You know, it's just playing with the malts to make sure you get nice color to it.
Yep.
When that's on, I mean, it's beautiful. It's a dark garnet, you know. You put it up to the white, and it's nice and red and everything.
Sweet.
The first beer was the simplicity. Here was the simplicity.
Yeah, here was the simplicity.
APA.
Yeah, that was our starter. That's not going to go anywhere. That'll stay forever.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
It was good enough to open the doors and get people to come back.
Well, so. That's awesome.
And it's your guy, obviously, early on now. So are you kind of playing with what you seeing people drink here to, you know, kind of...
Yeah, I know around here, like, the brown ales are going to be big.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of flavor. They like a lot of the malty stuff. Mm-hmm. So once we put the triple T on the Irish red, that was outselling everything.
That's a good sipper.
Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, so that's more of a direction that we're going to go here.
I already finished mine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good to the barbecue, too. Yeah.
So that's where we'll keep going with that. So we'll keep making the triple T. And like I said, just try the brown ale, man. It's awesome.
Well, let's take a quick break, and then we'll come back and actually we'll try a couple of the beers and talk more about your guys' beer, because we've been talking about Sam Adams, and that's not why we're here.
No,
let's grab a flight.
Let's
try some of the other ones
we haven't had yet.
Beauty.
If you're a craft beer guy who can't get it nearby, do yourself a favor and log into Tavour.
Blind Pig Confessions is the greatest podcast there ever was. My name is Dave Smiley from WZPL, and if you don't listen to this show, you're dumb.
Hey,
Beck. Thanks for whatever. I don't know whatever you put in there in the space.
Little Tavour and
little Tavour app, and which is always the best. I literally have 3 boxes still I haven't opened.
3?
Yeah, I kept forgetting I ordered stuff. I've spent about $1,000 in beer over the last 6 months probably. We have there's an app called Tavour.
Okay.
It's not a beer of the month club. They literally just pop up like 2 beers a day, and you swipe through. If you want to buy it, that's great. You buy a couple cans if you want, or buy a few cans, or bottles, or bombers, and they just put it all in a crate until the end of the month, and then they ship it. You spend enough, of the shipping's free. Otherwise, it's a flat $15.
Okay.
But you get to choose. And I probably spent about a grand in the last 6 months.
It's like the new Columbia Records.
Yes.
Ha ha.
Yeah.
The well, no, I mean, no, this, but no, this one is they don't just ship it to you. You have to buy. If I don't buy anything, I don't get anything.
Yeah.
But I can buy, if I buy like two beers, they're going to charge me $15 for shipping, but I don't have to buy anything. It's literally they just pop up all this stuff from all over the country around.
So you're three boxes in.
Yeah. Oh, I'm more than three, but I just have three boxes I haven't even opened yet.
Right. It's still good.
Yeah. Well, it should be. It's not sitting out in the garage in the heat.
Yeah.
It's in the house.
Yeah,
I just
keep it.
They're not shipped cold anyways, so they're all shipped at regular temperature anyways. So, but yeah, that's one of our big things we like to do. It's a great service if you want to get some stuff from around, like Adroit and Anchorage Brewing in Alaska. Really spectacular stuff.
Like places you can't just pop up and hey.
Yeah, they try to keep out of your zip code.
Yeah, they keep out of your zip code.
Let's go to Boulder, Colorado.
Yes, exactly. So it's a pretty awesome service. So, but yeah.
But we're not there. We're
not there. We're in Ledgeview.
This is true. Warsaw, Indiana.
Yes.
Good drop.
Yeah.
It's quite an invasion.
Did you hear it fall?
Yes.
Off.
All right. So we are going to get into the beer nerdy portion of this. So
that's why he's here.
Yes. Beer nerds are in attendance, and so we're all set to go.
I thought I'd join you with a 5-ouncer.
Just a 5-ouncer?
That's all I can get away with.
Is that the nitwit or is that the Nipah?
That is
the Nipah.
The Nipah.
I love the Nipah.
What do you got? The nitwit? Oh, no, that's...
No, I have the nitwit. I have
the nitwit. I was going to say, you had the cherry before.
Oh, yeah, that's
I'm going to get with the cherry.
Is that the Heffy? Is that what that is?
Yeah, this is the orange Hefeweizen.
All right.
So, walk us through our flight and where we're going to start first. I believe it was here.
You're going to start with the APA, the Simplicity. This is our American Pale Ale made with Simcoe hops.
So this one is the...
That's the very first beer we brewed here.
Okay, the Simplicity.
Yeah, it's the Simplicity, yes.
All right.
Simple beer, simple hops, and Simcoe hops. So.
Yeah.
Simplicity.
It was a great starter.
Although, what was it you said back in the brew room? If you do it wrong, it tastes like...
Cat piss.
There you go.
It's true, yeah.
And anyone that has an apartment with cats, you love that smell.
Oh, yeah, you know. Or you walk into someone's house, and they have cats.
Oh,
like,
I've done that a couple times.
They have cats.
Oh, yeah. It's like, why does it smell like really rancid tuna and urine? Yeah, it's just like, oh, this is awful.
Oh, that's why.
Yeah.
Oh.
And yet they still try to cover it up with, incense or some kind of plug-in air freshener. And I'm like, no, now it just smells like... Yeah, it just smells like Lysol flavored cat piss.
Flower scented piss.
Well, I always thought it was funny, living here in Indiana, that we're so close to the country and all the fields and stuff, and you'd see the stuff that says country scent. Do you realize what the country smells like?
Yeah.
You do not want to bottle that.
Yeah.
Oh,
ever,
oh yeah.
Can you ever driven by a pig farm? Yeah.
Chickens and pigs.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. Can you give me some horse apple there?
Yeah, some road apples.
So when you're making this one, you're kind of looking for a simple crossover. People come in and drink beer. I mean,
just a good one that they're not going to be intimidated by or anything like that.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. The hard thing is getting our number one question is, do you have anything that's like Bud Light?
Right.
Yes, of course. That's the craft brewer's nightmare.
Heavy sigh. Yeah.
So that's why the third beer we made here was a lager.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, it was the third one made, but it was like the fifth one that went on because lagers take a while.
And that's what's nice is it seems to be a lot more approachable even for the craft brewer. Lagering was just always out of everybody's.
Because it takes so long.
Yeah.
Realm of even wanting to try.
Yeah.
It's just if you don't have the ability to control the temperature, that's what scares you.
Yeah, because you got to stay colder.
Because as soon as you mess up the temperature, then you get the off flavor. You can't hide anything in a lager.
Yeah, it's a little hard to lager in your garage.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, he took up my refrigerator in the basement for about 6 months. I was ready to kill him. Like,
You started this.
That was a hell of an Oktoberfest, though.
This is true.
You can't blame him. You started this.
That was his pass. That's when I threw up my hands. I was like, all right, fine.
It was my fault. All right, well, we'll keep going.
Yeah, it's a great clean.
No, it's actually very clean.
Yeah, it's somebody coming in here and not, craft beer, non-craft beer drinking. This is the one
you... It's not even...
That's what we did with it at first.
It's not a heavy-handed hop. You're not... You're not double dry hopping this.
Exactly. We started off with a double dry hop right off the bat. I mean, probably wouldn't have a lot of repeat customers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Probably not where you're at. I mean, 5 years ago, everybody started out with a whatever, however many hops they could throw in a beer to begin with. Now they realize you need a slightly more approachable beer.
Yeah. I think after Stone, I'll go right to it. Stone Ruination. If you've ever had that beer, the purpose of that beer was essentially, like, how high can the IBUs go?
Yeah,
just like rip your face off.
And it does. It rips your mouth right off your face, and you're walking around like a zombie after. And you can't taste anything.
I just blew out my palate. Thank you.
Yeah. So. It's like goes more on to, you know, oh, I'm gonna eat I'm gonna eat myself a scorpion pepper just because you know it's a scorpion pepper challenge. But then it's a hop challenge at that point. Just chew a few hops in your mouth and drink a beer.
So at that point, it just became like, okay, I bought a 6-pack of this stuff. So who gets it? All
right. Right, you're giving it out.
Exactly.
They're like, oh, you're going to love this. Try this, buddy.
You wait till the brother or the cousin comes over and they're already half tanked. You're like, oh, I got a great beer for you now. And you see them, they're just like scraping their tongue on the table trying to get the flavor out of them.
I have a mini fridge of the leftovers so like if I'm getting in, you know, through Tavour just going somewhere and getting a batch for a show we're going to do. I have a mini fridge of rejects that I'm trying to get rid of.
I box those up and give it to Ryan for Christmas.
It's perfect.
That's pretty good.
Here, try these. They're super unique.
Yeah, I'm totally going to start doing that then. Yeah. Yep. I'm totally going to start doing that. Just sending it all to Ryan. Here, he'll drink it.
Or you get those holiday packs that have that one beer that nobody likes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the cranberry wheat.
The cranberry lambic.
Oh, the lambic.
Nobody likes the
cranberry lambic.
I love lambics, though.
Oh, this was horrible, though. Even Dennis Leary. You listen to Dennis Leary, Lock and Load, his second album.
He talks
about it.
All right. I think I might marry her at this point because she's rolling Kevin Smith and Dennis Leary freaking drops on me, man. Good on you, buddy. Good on you, Craig. Good catch, bud.
That's right. He married up.
Right.
Goodness gracious.
Nice. You know, he has a nice bit about that. You should check it out.
Awesome. I'm loving all the quotes because it's right up my alley. Excellent. I'll have to look at the Dennis Leary one, but I still like lambics. I can't. But cranberry is a bit, cranberry's touchy.
I gotta be in the mood. I mean, I don't mind a lambic every now and then, but.
Well, no, I'm not gonna, it's not my go-to every night. Hey, it's been a hard day, let me bust out a lambic. No.
It's like a goza. I go through, ooh, yeah, this is refreshing.
Yes.
I like a good goza.
I love a good goza, too.
Yeah.
I am on the sour end of it.
Well, if you're on it, then you're definitely there.
I love gozas and especially like the pickle beers, you know, your cucumber or the pickle sours, any of those.
I'll try anything once, honestly.
They are super refreshing. But that's just me. I lean all the way to the other end of the spectrum. Darks.
Oh, yeah.
Middle of the road is where I get kind of wishy-washy. You know, those are where I just really like to go. So, but this is beautiful.
You know, well, one thing I liked about this, about the APA, that simplicity, was the people who came in, I don't like hoppy beers.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like hoppy beers. Try it. Mm-hmm. Just try it. And, like, Tony's a good example. And he, you know what? This is actually pretty good. So it's like an introductory. Yes.
I always
hop beer.
Sold it as it just has one hop.
Yes, but they have to understand it, all beers have hops in it. Sorry,
have it.
they've been scared and spoiled
right
over the years
because of the craft beer got boomed here. It was it was all IPAs and
all
big
IPAs.
Yeah. Big, you know, so that's how I kind of related to it, you know. So it's just different. I mean, it's different all over the country, whatever, you know, was big when it kind of boomed.
Yep.
You know, Michigan was completely different when it boomed than we weren't, you know, nobody was doing IPAs and shit like that. So
it's just
different.
That's not the only beer that I try to push, and I get a really good feedback when they were like, oh.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's not bad.
Yeah, there's more than just that simplicity.
What's great is you get them to drink that, then you can start. You know, and then you start going up and getting them other stuff.
But they get adventurous on their own after that, though, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's great.
I always ask them, what's your palate?
Yeah, what do you like?
Well, they don't know.
Yeah, our blender bender. I get that one with the ladies who don't like beer.
Their beer doesn't taste like beer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
Oh, no.
We were.
Now we're coming back to Dennis Leary, beer flavored beer.
We did like two. Was it 2 years ago? We did the Madam Carol over in Monticello.
Yeah.
It was a boat beer festival.
Okay.
It was literally all on a
3-hour tour. It was
3-hour tour.
You were stuck on it.
You were stuck on a boat with everybody, all the beers, and you were just on the boat. But there were at least three ladies coming up. Do you have anything that's not beer? I'm like, you just paid like $40 to be on a beer tour for 3 hours where you can't get off. Really?
I got some ice water that the beer's sitting in.
Right.
I know your demographic.
It's quite refreshing.
Well, thankfully, Mullins from Broad Ripple Brew Pub and like another brewery had brought in like, was there the... Fizzy lifting drink. They were doing seltzers at least.
But
again, you consciously knew this was a beer festival on a boat. And you wanted something that didn't taste like beer.
Yes.
When
COVID hit, right before COVID hit and they shut everything down, Craig and I were able to get into a night shift brewery in Boston. And all the college kids that were there, the girls were all drinking hard seltzers.
Yeah.
Every single one of them. I don't think I saw one drinking an actual beer. I think I was the only girl in there drinking a beer.
That's right. That's right.
Because that's how I roll.
That's right. High and tight.
It's a bummer that line is that's still there, though. You know, beer is approachable, and there should be no. Yeah, it's like
when we talked about fancy restaurant. You know, it has its time and its place.
Sure.
But I just found it. I'm like looking around, like this is bizarre. No. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, it's a pretty much a guaranteed revenue source right now.
It is.
But I'm not going to get into it.
Yeah.
I mean, you can crank it out for no money, and it's great. But there's nothing wrong with it. Again, I don't hate on seltzer or anything like that.
No, I don't hate on seltzer.
I like it.
I was more laughing at someone who literally bought like a $40 ticket on a beer tour and didn't want beer.
Well, it's like going to a wine festival and you don't drink wine.
Yeah, I don't like beer.
And they had an hour before we launched. They could have got off the boat.
Yeah, yeah. Literally, it's like...
Took a look around. Hey, there's no beer. And
it's like, I don't like beer, but you're on a beer tour. Jesus. Yeah, it's like, I don't like barbecue, but you're at a barbecue restaurant. You got anything that's not barbecue? Yeah, so...
Yeah, exactly.
We got some really good applesauce.
There you go. Beer. Would you like me to mash that up with something else for you?
Yeah.
Where do we want to go next? Where are we headed?
We're
going to switch back now and start drinking.
The Swamp Monster Stout.
Swamp Monster.
Okay. Swamp Monster. Unfiltered stout. So you put it up to the light. It's murky as all hell.
Mm-hmm.
Yummy.
And you know you're in for a treat on that one.
It's called muddy or murky?
Murky.
Murky. It's got a nice chocolate coffee with a little brass finish, I'd like to add.
There you go.
What's the brass finish? I've never heard that description. On the brass finish.
Well, you go ahead and take a sip and let me know.
Well, I've never really sucked on anything brass, so I'm not really sure.
Today be your first day.
We can change that for you if you'd like.
This tastes like brass.
Delightful.
I like the stock. But we always talking about people not having stouts in the summertime. It's like, why not? You can still have a stout in the summertime, and this is a perfect one because it's a nice light.
It's very dry on the back end.
Yes, it's not a sweet stout.
Is that the brassy? Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. It attenuated out very well.
We did not want it to be sweet.
I didn't want that one to be sweet.
I thank you for that. Some of them can be too sweet.
There's a lot of porters and stouts now. It's hard to decipher a lot of places you go into of what they're trying to do, and they say it's this, and if it's not, but
yeah, and I'm like, no, that's
so it's
a
nice
porter.
When someone says it's a stout, and it's a stout.
It's a dry stout.
I think I introduced that to you, Brendan, when you came in, because I know your palate a little bit.
Yeah, I like it.
And there's a place for like all the lactose and stuff like that, but it's not in that beer.
Right. No lactose in this one?
No lactose in that one.
What's the hops?
The hops is a traditional like UK, Kent Goldings and Willamette.
Okay. All right, I like the Willamette.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. No, I like the unfiltered part. Adds a little extra depth and character to the mouthfeel on that one. It kind of feels like it replaces what the lactose would be. At least gives that little bit extra mouthfeel without having to throw the lactose in to get that creamy mouthfeel and stuff. So
it's cheating.
That's not cheating.
Yeah, I did. I went a little higher on the oats on that one just to get more of the mouthfeel to it. But
it's great.
No, I always the oats. I think you get a better creamy texture. It doesn't taste fake.
Lactose feels cheating.
You know? Yeah,
lactose feels
that's
like cheating.
Lactose.
Oh, okay.
Cheating,
I thought you meant he was cheating by not using lactose. I'm like,
no. Oats.
I'm not sure how you're getting that, buddy.
Yeah, it's delicious.
Where are you getting your grains from? And are you trying to work as local as you can? Or
I'm trying to still.
It's hard. It's hard.
Yeah, it's hard. Like this brown ale, I don't want to call it an American brown ale. I want to call it the Indiana brown ale.
Okay.
And I want, you know, the grains, the hops.
Yeah, sure.
We want to.
Yeah, right. We want to.
But we can't right now.
Yet.
You know, it's partial. I mean, the only thing in Indiana is the water and the maple syrup in there right now.
Well, that water will give you a nice day.
That's huge.
Wait, you said what's the maple syrup you said?
The maple syrup.
Where's that from?
It's from just south of us in Claypool, Beachlers.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, we hooked up with them, 3 months ago?
Mm-hmm.
I think we put some of their maple syrup in the...
Some's in the Dominatrix
as well.
Dominatrix is our... what is that?
It's the Belgian Dark.
The Belgian Dark.
Yeah, she wouldn't let me start out with that one.
No, that's a little bit. I don't want to do that.
Before
goes against
that's,
all
that's before nap
rules.
Time.
Kindergarten rules here. You got to take a nap.
Craft brewery NyQuil, right, at that point.
We had a hard time trying to figure out a lot of our beers, you know, coming up with a name. Actually, some of the beers that we've named, the names just came, like, super,
who did this one?
Super quick. That was a combination. So, it was mostly Craig.
Oh, he's like,
I seen the eye roll.
You said combination.
It's always a collaboration, but it stems from an experience that he had in Newport.
Yeah. You know, when you go out drinking with a bunch of Irish guys, and they like to call the lasses swampies.
These are
a
swamp. It's a swampy.
It's a swampy.
What's a swampy?
A swampy is a girl that you do not bring home to mother.
Bless the swampies.
Let's put it that way.
So I wanted to call it that, and
they might have wrote a song about that.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's been a few songs written about.
So in my own way, it's called that, but it's the swamp monster. It still has the same meaning. And
so we're gonna call it. So sometimes you'll hear me call it the swampy or the swampy when it's really the swamp monster.
All right, I gotcha.
So that's where it came from.
I still call it a swampy.
You can take that, Brendan, with
it's
you.
It's actually written on top of the tap over there. So swampy.
It says swampy on the tap. Call it the swamp monster, but swampy.
That is spectacular. I love that. How about the? I mean, obviously simplicity and is it you? Do you design any? Are you getting into it and designing any of the recipes at all, or is Craig you mainly taking all control of that?
She's just drinking them.
Okay,
I enjoy.
There, you tell him when it's this is good.
He's the beer
don't
guy.
Do this.
My background is with service and wine.
Right.
So I taste.
You're like, pairing.
I pair. I come up with the flight boards, like the order you should drink them in. We go back and forth. I'm very particular about how I put the beers down and in the order in which you should drink them. And
awesome.
I have very good reasons for that.
You don't want to blow out your palate with with the IBUs and go into something soft after that. Like,
right.
True.
You're not going to taste it.
But then you get into like the two you're about to have next. We have the Flying Tsunami, which the IBUs are, 60? I think 65 on that one?
65.
And then you have the NIPA, which is a little bit softer, but the issue with the NIPA, not that it's an issue.
It's those hops.
It's the hops that we're using have a bit more background to them.
Sure.
So if you're going to have the NIPA first and then have the Tsunami, you'd be like, oh, this is so boring.
Yes.
But if you have the Tsunami first, and so you have to take each with like a little grain of salt.
And I think that's probably one of the biggest things on Untappd that you see. Like, there's a lot of breweries, you know, they take some, you know, some critique and stuff, undeserved critiques.
Absolutely.
And I think a lot of it is from the flight boards. I think people are blasting out their palates.
Yeah. People have no idea how to actually approach a flight board. They're just like, there, and then they'll drink the stout first, and then they're going
to
even after, at some point, it doesn't even matter. You know, when you're drinking, you're trying to do 20 samples. Don't give me one everything you got. You're not
running a palate cleanser in between. Always going to be spoiled.
Well, it's funny because sometimes people come up and they'll give you this impossible combination. And I look at them like, oh, my gosh, how am I going to do this? And I've actually said to them, okay, you want to drink 1, 2, 3, then eat some barbecue, and then have your fourth one.
Right.
Because there's no way I can do that and have them enjoy that last beer.
Oh, of course not.
Now, have you thought about doing like a food pairing night or anything like that, and beer and food?
We've talked about it. Hasn't happened yet. We're still, we've only been open since we opened in December.
Yeah. Yeah.
December for carry out, and then January for dine in, and then the beer. Our first beer was actually served the last weekend of March.
Okay.
So today's August 14th.
August 14th.
I don't know when you guys are gonna post this, but So next week. Okay, yeah. Cool. So it's been 5 months. We've only had the beer up for 5 months. So we're still babies.
We're infants.
When did you close?
Yeah. We're infants.
When did you close on the place?
July 23rd, 2020.
In the middle of everything.
In the middle of everything. So we're either crazy stupid or crazy brilliant.
Not any particular order.
I think you need a little bit of both.
You were a little, little bit lucky, a little bit unlucky. At least it wasn't. At least you didn't buy it in December of 2019.
That's true.
Because I know a few places that were doing that, and then they literally, you know, it was like, oh, we just spent all this money, and now we can't open.
Well, we found
and they couldn't even get beers out to get people to try it, or the food out to get people to say, okay, we can do takeout orders. There's no takeout orders.
Yeah, because if you're going to do that, you want to do it from a place that's established, that you're familiar with. Why would you do takeout from someplace you've never even heard of?
Yeah, we started looking at this place in, September of 2019.
19, yeah. We put on our offer in October. Lawyers and everybody got involved in November. Then the holidays happened.
6 months of really 6 months.
Everything.
Everything happened with COVID right around what?
Yeah, that slowed us down.
Just filing anything with the government at that point just stopped.
Yeah. Yep, absolutely. And then finally, we got our closing date of July 23rd. So we sold the house in Massachusetts. We moved out here. I think we were homeless for 13 days. We were like couch surfing, and we have two kids. By the way, so but we made it work. It was interesting. I'm the planner, so I made it work. But we got here, we closed on the house, and then I told Craig, I have you at the house for 1 week, and then you can go play at your brewery, and then let's get the kids in school, and then I will come and help because I got to make this house livable.
Yeah.
And then we started working, and we tore the place apart. We took down the ceiling. This whole room was just gutted. It was gutted. We gutted this entire room.
Yep.
Now, you were from Goshen.
Yeah.
What brought you to Warsaw? What brought you to this building?
I made a promise to her when we started, you know, taking everything seriously, that I would take her back home one day. And I honestly thought it was going to be after I retire.
Yeah, we thought it was our retirement plan.
I'm like, cool, you know.
You can't retire in Massachusetts. It's too expensive. Yeah.
Shoot some guns, go fishing, and play some golf, and it'll be fine.
Yeah. Have low property tax.
It'll be fine.
I'm fine. Everything's fine.
So this is my retirement.
I mean, to be honest,
not yet.
To be honest, you still haven't gotten her home, but you're close enough.
Well, same state. It counts.
So one day Craig said to me, you know, he'd made his way up the executive chef ladder. He'd been the executive chef at two different places, and he said, you know, all I want to do, because he'd been homebrewing for 3-4 years at this point?
I don't know.
A couple years. I just want to cook barbecue and brew beer. That's all I want to do.
Go back a little more simple.
Yeah, so I called a friend of mine. I was just happened to be on the phone with a friend of mine, Mary Kay.
Yep.
And said, this is what Craig and I were talking about, haha. She's like, actually, what you just described is for sale in Warsaw.
Oh.
These two guys were doing it. Something happened.
Yeah, this was...
They parted ways.
This was what before?
It was Ortho City.
Okay.
So they parted ways.
I remember that one.
And the place is for sale, so check it out. So we cyber-stalked it for about a month, and then we messaged them and said, hey, this is who we are. This is what we want to do. We heard back. We went back and forth for quite a while, and then we flew it. And that's when, you know, Craig had mentioned that we flew out and looked at the place in September of 2019. Mm. So this all actually started... during the summer of 2019, before the word COVID wasn't even being whispered on the dark web.
Yep.
And then the rest of what I've already told you.
Their website's still up.
Ooh.
We still have a website still going.
Hey.
That's weird. But they're open and kid-friendly.
Well.
Sorry, I was just Googling Ortho City because I'd never heard of them. And I was just like, oh, look, they still got a webpage.
So that's crazy.
But yeah, we got lucky because when we put our offer on the place, it included the building, the property, and all the
kitchen,
almost all the equipment. The kettles, the kettles actually belong to their brewer.
Uh-huh.
So he, of course, took those with him.
Gotcha.
But ironically, you were on, what's that website you always go on to look for?
One of the websites that you can buy secondhand brewing stuff.
Yeah. And he put his kettles up there. And Craig said, hey!
Can you just put them back where they were now?
Yeah, exactly. We wouldn't have to worry about shipping. We wouldn't have to worry about... And he's like, I've already sold them. Man. But then, you know, when you put stuff on the second... When you look at that secondary market, the price isn't really that much different. So I think they run... He put them up for $15,000, but a brand new system from Blichman was going to cost $16,000. That's like... okay, use system. I'm going to save $1,000 for a system that's already used, so I might as well just already. I mean, it was already gone, so we might as well just buy new.
Yeah, definitely.
And you went with the awesome Blichman system back there. Yeah. It's beautiful. Yeah.
It's Lafayette.
Spend a little more, going to last a little longer. You know, you got some nice dial in, all electric, right? You know,
anything breaks, they're only like 2 hours south.
Right.
Of us.
Yeah. Exactly.
Blichman's amazing.
South we know West. We know Josh from there. He's he's an engineer in there from Crawfordsville.
Backstep,
the original
Josh
brewer,
Miller.
Backstep Brewing, Josh Miller. He ended up.
Josh.
There are two Joshes that
work there, and I always get them confused.
Josh Miller was the original brewer over at Backstep, and he still works a lot for them. But yeah, he went over to their engineering division to because he's one of the engineering brewers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's you know where everything's
he's
really
he's meticulous.
Oh, he's meticulous on stuff, and God love him. It's great. It's great beer.
Yeah,
The wind shifts. You got a chance to throw his bad gel, you know.
Yeah, if you get a chance to go to Crawfordsville, Backstep's got some good stuff.
Okay.
Going on.
Well, I have a family down in Terre Haute, so going to Crawfordsville is not outside the realm of possibility.
If you I would make it a must.
Yeah,
it's an amazing. It's a great brewery, great guys,
awesome,
and
awesome little place. Awesome place, kind of like this. You know, it just built in brick and a nice old, you know, it's all firehouse stuff because the owners are firemen and stuff.
Very cool.
It's really good stuff.
No barbecue there, though. Talking about St. Louis barbecue, are you doing St. Louis style barbecue here?
Oh, we do St. Louis.
And what are you doing your own style?
And what does that mean?
Technically, St. Louis style means the cut, correct?
Well, the St. Louis rib is the cut of the rib. You know, it's the spare rib, and they trim off the ends.
Okay.
And so it's a nice, clean, rectangle cut of ribs.
Mm-hmm.
And we use those hair, but we don't use their spices. I don't know what Pappy's did. You know, that's his business.
Yeah. Well, that's like trade secret stuff.
Sure, of course.
Yeah. So ours is like in the middle of like. We don't mop ours. We don't put a bunch of sauces on it.
Okay.
You know? We smoke them with dry rub on them, and then we wrap them up afterwards, and you know they glaze themselves.
Yeah.
And we serve them without sauce on them because it already has the glaze on them.
Yeah. Sure. We keep our sauces on the table. People always ask me, is your barbecue? What's the sauce on your barbecue? No, there is no sauce on our barbecue.
Yeah,
we do it yourself.
Yeah, we don't pre-sauce.
Well, we have a wonderful glaze that they do top. Can we talk about that? Because it is divine.
On the ribs, right?
On the ribs.
Yeah, that's true.
Oof.
Yeah.
It's all cooked in itself. It's yummy.
Very rarely, but occasionally we'll get someone that says, oh, can I get those dry? Yes, we can do it.
Who's running
but
this?
But you really don't want to. That's so good. That glaze is so good.
The glaze is
that
the bomb.
Good, huh?
Who's running the smokehouse?
Me.
You run the smokehouse and the brewery?
Yep.
Where? Okay.
I don't.
Did I miss the smokehouse though?
It's back behind.
It's outside.
So if we'd gone out that back door, that's where all the smokers are.
Okay, gotcha.
It's down the yellow brick road, actually.
Because I didn't see the smokehouse. I just saw the kitchen. Okay.
Gotta get past the lollipop.
I guess.
Yep. Wow.
That get a little tiresome? I mean,
yeah. So usually I put my meats on for the night, for the overnight, and the briskets, pork butts, they go on about 8, 9 o'clock at night.
Is that a Blichman system too?
No.
Making Blichman
smoker. They're not there yet.
It's a one-stop shop.
Yeah. So I'll put all the meats on, and then I'll start brewing, or I'll start kegging, and 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, I'll come home.
There's a cot back there.
Yeah. So the way we do it, because like with the kids, so I'm here early, and I'm home for the evening. He's home in the morning, and then we kind of have someone that we have a couple babysitters that help us out during the day.
Oh,
it's obviously easier doing this during the school year.
Sure.
But you make it. It's. I remember talking to people who were having kids. I'm like, how do you make it work? You just do.
Yeah, to do it. Yeah.
You just make it.
That's why we have high. That's why we have high chairs at the bar.
Yeah.
You just plop the kids in.
Yeah, it makes it so much easier.
So what are you guys making? I saw a few things. What's your big? What are your big sellers? Or what kind you're doing? You're doing brisket and ribs, right? Anything else?
Oh, the sweet potato nachos.
Oh, yeah, it's for the win, and I do tell some of our patrons that once you do it, it's all downhill from there because you just keep coming back.
Yeah.
What did you say?
Good
the sweet potato.
Is hard
so
to get
it's
away
sweet
from
potato
it.
Nachos. So what we do is we take a sweet potato waffle fry and we dust it in our dust. Mm-hmm. And our spices, a spice blend that Craig came up with.
It's a sweet savory.
It's a sweet and savory, a little bit of cinnamon in there. And then we top it like nachos. So we put on the pulled pork. We have a house-made queso that we make every morning.
Beauty.
And it has a little bit of a kick to it. And then sour cream, green onion, tomato, and pickled Fresnos that we pickle ourselves.
Sure.
This is 95% of our menu is scratch. Nice. We make our menu. I think there's only five things on there we don't make.
French fries and buns.
French fries, buns, and the applesauce. We don't make the applesauce.
Are you you're smoking pork?
Pork.
Turkey or anything? Whether you
turkey,
you
we'll probably
sausage?
Do that for the I think we'll do turkey for the holidays.
That'll be a seasonal.
Smoked sausages?
That seasonal. Yeah. He wants to do sausages.
Yep. Oh, you're not doing currently?
I haven't found a local one yet that's, you know, I'm loving.
Right.
When I do, though, we'll run with that.
Awesome. Any plans on anything like weird, like, you know, getting some exotic meats and smoking some, you know, like some gator, meat?
Oh, gator.
Well, I don't know if I'm over that or not. I mean, back in,
kangaroo?
99 and 2000, I was at a restaurant and it was called a Safari Lounge.
Yes.
And everything had to be something. So we had ostrich on there. I've had that. We had antelope.
I have not had antelope.
All that
yet.
Stuff. It was always something different that had to go on there.
I used to do that a lot and find a place in something, you know. I've had like a bear steak, you know, and kangaroo and
ostrich. Have you ever tried rattlesnake?
I have had rattlesnake.
Did you like it?
It was all right.
Okay.
I wasn't too keen on it. But okay. I like to search out for some of those. But some places will do like some exotic smoked meats because it's easier to smoke that than just try to figure out any other way to serve it.
Sure. Are those places that serve bugs, you know, like grasshoppers?
Oh, God,
and,
no.
Okay.
No, there. No, nope, that's not meat.
Did I cross a line?
Protein.
That's not meat. That's not meat.
Anything here,
it's the
too.
The food of the future.
That's
yeah. Nope. I think we made meat. Our mark with the squirrel stew.
Yeah, which is just a beer.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
Craig took off the headphones.
What'd you do? What happened? Talking about bugs?
I crossed the line.
Uh-oh.
Well, you know, there's some crazy stuff out there.
There is. I've been.
That's what I'm referencing.
Trust me, I know. I've been to China. I've been to street vendor foods in China.
Ooh.
Oh boy, there's some weird shit going on down that street.
Well, in Korea, well, they serve dog, don't they?
You can get it in China too. I almost did try it.
But from what I understand, it's a very specific. It's like the way we breed cows.
Yes.
It's a very specific dog breed.
The one restaurant, so I went out
it's
for like
corgi,
2 weeks.
I think.
Yeah.
It's all corgi.
It's all corgis. Yeah, there's a lot of butt meat. There's a lot of butt meat on those corgis.
Don't tell the queen.
No, I went out to China for a couple of weeks, and I flew in, and the first restaurant we went to right after my, you know, like 18-hour flight and whatever and all that, they had it, and my buddy's like, do you want it? I'm like, I just can't do it. Nope. Not on the first night here. No, I'm just not. So it just had fish head soup and spicy.
Oh, okay.
And spicy intestine.
Fido tempura.
Great, yeah.
All right, beautiful. I'm holding my NEPA for the
I'm not. I'm drinking.
Oh, yeah. I don't know what this is.
Stop talking about
this
beer.
Is not
this
the NEPA.
This is the heavy, right?
This is the flying tsunami.
The flying tsunami. Okay, this is the flying tsunami.
Flying tsunami. Galaxy Hops and Sriracha Ace.
Sriracha what?
Sriracha Ace.
What
Sriracha. Sriracha Ace. It's from, it's a Japanese hop.
Is it?
Sriracha? No, you wish it does, but it's got a bunch of lime.
It's got
a bunch of lime to it, the Galaxy hops. So, you know, it's with the flying tsunami, so you got the Galaxy and the
thing
together.
This is named after a move that his brothers came up with when they would
wrestling.
Attack each other.
Yeah. Wrestling move.
As brothers tend to do.
Yeah, it's a knee to the midsection or a punch to the face. Which one do you want to take at the same time?
After diving off a table or something,
If you block one, you get the other. You cannot do
I
both.
Think in the end, he ended up in the dryer.
Yeah. You can no defend. If you do right, you can no defend.
That's the one I knew I'd seen a hop on there that I'd never heard of before.
No, that's one I have not heard of. That is definitely adds something different to that one.
It started off when it came out of the bright tank and everything. It was a bit much. It was almost too much. You couldn't distinguish anything on the palate.
Really?
And after it sat for about a week, you had to
leveled out a little.
Just had to condition it in the tanks by themselves.
Yeah. Okay.
Now it's like you get the more of the caramel out of the. Out of the malt bill and everything, and then you start getting the hops. But at first, it was just too much.
All in your face? Mm. A little too much punch in the face?
Well, that's what I mean.
Too much punch in the face.
That's a perfect tsunami.
Exactly. No, that's beautiful. It's real smooth. It's really not a heavy hop at all after you've conditioned it.
We just wanted
that sriracha hop just adds something. I'm trying to. You said the lime, and maybe that's a little bit of lime.
And
or
that hit me as orange, but it's lime.
That's entirely different. But I'm
catching the
that.
Citrus component.
Yeah, it's not bad. I like that one.
And you call it it's an APA.
And I'm colorblind.
No, that's like a West Coast IPA.
Okay.
Yeah, we needed a West Coast version. I got the NEPA. I had to come up with the NEPA, or I had to come from New England.
It had to follow me.
You know?
Sure.
But I also had, and there's a lot of people that just want a good old Westie. So
sure.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
I like it. No, that's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Even after sitting for a little bit, it's still actually very. It's not like, you know, I'm bigger on nice cold IPAs just because sometimes the hop, it negates a little bit of the too much hoppiness. But even just sitting here, even at a nice, even temperature, it's still really good. It's got a lot of flavor, got a lot of character to it.
Well, sometimes the flavors will start to come out as they sit. Because sometimes if something's too cold, you won't catch everything.
But IPAs tend to, I like them better cold because.
Oh, absolutely.
But depending on, usually when you're in that IPA or even APA range.
That's because you don't want to hit the big.
I don't want.
You're looking. No.
I'm probably looking to subdue a little bit because I'm not big on the hops.
Well, there's also the old adage that a warm beer is an angry beer.
True.
Yeah.
I can't do it. It's got to be cold. I'm a baby.
Well, not if I get a nice stout or a porter can be, especially if it's a barrel aged something. You want that warmed up a little bit. If you're putting anything above. Anything in that 10% or even any stout, you need a little bit of warmth on that to really get everything out.
I think I embarrassed Brennan one night when we got a warmer beer, and I asked for a cold glass, and that's the way it was supposed to be served.
Yeah, I ducked and
put
my jacket over my head.
Did she order a KBS and a frosty mug? Yeah. Was that what it was? She ordered a KBS? Yeah, can I get that nice 12%er and a frosty mug, please? Yeah.
That's full me.
Yeah, no, please don't.
Extra ice on the glass for me.
Can you just put some ice in it? That'd be great.
I tried.
The girls are here.
What girls are here?
My girls are here.
Oh.
Aww.
Your kids are here?
Yeah. Should we? Do you think we should take a break?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's take a little break.
We'll take a break, and we'll finish off with our last, that was the NEPA. We'll get Craig to talk about New England.
New England. Yeah. It's not too far. Grab the car. It'll be great.
Pack the car.
All right. Cheers.
The city's on fire. Come watch it burn with me. She said she won't feel. behind. We hear these words from high above, and don't let your heart be troubled.